always enjoy seeing you, man. I always appreciate the time because I appreciate what you do with your art so much. And you've done it again with this album, Sick Girl. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well.
Tabula rasa, the clean slate, right? Empiricism at its finest. Everything that is on the mind is learned and absorbed and experienced. I wonder how important that statement is for the album as a whole, because it feels a little bit like that to me listening to it. Like you're sort of in a clearing or a different space than you've been before.
Maybe. I feel like that concept could be a bit aspirational, though, because I feel like there's context for everything. Like in life, like we come from something. We don't occupy a space of nothingness.
Right. And how do you aspire to a clean slate once life begins? Because surely it's the antithesis of what you're supposed to do, which is gain experience after experience after experience.
Well, it ends up being an attempt more than like a state.
It's a practice.
Like that's what the purpose kind of that song was. Even when I pitched it to Woods and Elucid, because I asked them to set it off. Mm-hmm. And they were like asking me conceptually what I wanted to do. And then because of kind of the gospel thing, I'm like a confessional. Mm.
The really crazy thing is, and you've talked about this throughout your music, most of the stuff you absorb that ends up sitting on life's path, you don't actually ask for and have zero control over.
True, yeah.
You sort of inherit that experience and then it sort of informs the next experience. And by the time you grow up old enough for people to say, take control of your life, you're like, but I was out of control for 18 years.
Like, bruh, like I was exploring. Yeah. Like, yeah. I saw someone say something about that the other day. Like, a child's job is to, like, explore. Like, you're not informed enough to make life decisions.
Totally.
You're exploring, you're learning. But that's kind of the nature of the beast, bruh, of life. Like, this is not nice. You know what I mean? It's not designed kind of to be. My friend said his father told him that, like, when he was younger. He was, like, complaining that he wasn't happy. He was like, that's not in the pamphlet. Like, you're not supposed to be happy all the time.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Very much so. I love that realization. As stark as that is an observation for a child to hear, especially coming from someone who's.
This is an African parent of a, you know, African child. That is real.
Yeah. But what it does is it actually sets a bar of, it sets a level of expectation from a personal level, right? Between those two people in terms of the skills and the tools you'll need in order to try to get to a place where.
To navigate.
Yeah, navigate.
And it builds trust too.
Yeah, it does. True. Honesty and truth.
Because the song before that one is the, it ends with the quote on that.
Yeah.
What did she say? It's from a Black Fairy record. She's asking about magic. Then the magic of make-believe, and then Elucid tells the truth. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. And Billy Wiz tells the truth. He cooked chicken in his boxes late night. The truth is oftentimes the most beautiful shit. Woods always shows you that. It's in the little details of Woods writing. Because that I was thinking about that the other day of, like, even just letting the thought out publicly with on whatever platform of, like, to other artists, however much life and experience you put into it is what people are going to be able to get out of it.
Well, the maximum they're going to be able to get out of it.
Exactly.
You know, for you as an artist who I think embraces density.
For sure, because it's an attractive thing to me, bro. Like mastery, like of self is a, that's what I'm the most excited about of being in control of my writing. It's like, man, I can be a good magician. It's, you know what I mean? If that's the allegory, if the writing is magic and I'm not really in control of it, someone might die or something, or I might like really cut this woman in half. You know what is better allegory? It's like a driver.
Right.
It's like I'm driving a car and you're the passenger as the listener. If I'm a really good driver, if I have total mastery of this car, we can have a bit more fun. Like you might not know where we're going. Or like how we're gonna, but I can like go off of the road.
I get, man, and that's what I love about this album and the albums leading up to this point. Cause man, with you, I just feel like I'm always peeling another layer. And sometimes it's the same fucking onion. You know, it's just like, oh, that's another line. That's another line. That's another line.
Yeah,
density.
Man.
You love density.
I love density. I wanna live after I'm dead, right? That's how you. It'll be fun. It's here. Like you can. Go there. It's part of the relationship I have with even my father. Mm. It's like I get to interact with the man through peeling. Mm. It's there. You know what I mean?
That's a beautiful silver lining that you've developed. That's a real growth because The other flip side of that is anger and resentment and frustration.
It was a bit of a trade-off. This is a prolific writer.
Yeah.
Didn't really have time to like watch the paint peel with me, like at the crib while I eat sometimes. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then, you know, when he passed, it was tough. But post, it's like, oh, and as my brain has grown and my capacity for understanding has grown, as like, oh, okay. Funny. Like,
parenthood's a weird thing. They write enough books about it. People get rich off manuals, but man, there's no manual for that.
There's really not. And just like how we said at the beginning of this, talking about the clean slate and all that.
Yeah.
And about parenting, it's like, I'm on the side of being a responsible driver so that I can tell the truth. Because we're dealing with a volatile substance.
Yeah. It's not designed for you to necessarily be happy by default.
This is what I'm saying. And it's hard. I even said some like that on Feet of Clay. Because I had seen it with my nephew. I watched a child get introduced to violence. Like, that's crazy. That's hard. That's tough for you as an adult. But it's also like, damn, this shit is real. I'm at the park with my nephew in South Africa. And my nephew's the sweetest kid. He was probably like 5 or 6. And you know, it's South Africa, less than 30 years out from apartheid. Mm-hmm. White kid comes up to my nephew as he's about to go on the slide. No, you don't go. Like, you can't go. My nephew doesn't know that what he's interacting with.
Yeah.
And I'm like livid. I pull my nephew to the side like, yo, never, ever, ever let nobody blah, blah, blah. And I had a whole thing with my sister was like trying to navigate it of like kind of preserve his innocence or whatever. I'm like, what the f*** do you mean? Like,
but you're both right. You know that, right?
We are both right. But I'm saying what is guaranteed, like I said at the beginning, what is guaranteed in this life is like, especially as a young Black boy.
Yeah.
They coming. There is an assault on your identity that is coming. So, sorry, bye-bye, if I have to tell you what is coming.
I already know the answer to this question, but I feel compelled to ask it. Will you afford the same level of unfiltered truth to your own child?
He's like not 18 months. I'll talk about systemic racism with this guy. I keep the ceiling high for this guy.
Yeah, I knew that was the answer.
That's how I was dealt with. Because you also see it with children. If you keep it real with children, and by the time they're about 5 and 6, like, and this is, I'm just saying, in my family, see what type of sentences children start saying if you treat them with a certain level of seriousness and intelligence. Like, see what they have to say by the time they're, like, 8 years old.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, the mind is at its most absorbent. And, yeah, no, you're right. And it's funny because as parents, man, and I'm sure you feel this too, because I know how much you love your kid, right? You're a thoughtful and caring and emotionally intelligent person. So you got to feel that you know you also feel that instinct to want to protect and nurture in different ways. And so it's actually a discipline and a commitment and hard work to do the other thing, because your instinct goes the other way, right?
But that's where the protection instinct is the truth. Mm. That's what I'm saying in the quote on the Vision song. It's like, I am not going to injure this child with lies about the world so that he can come out here and have his mirage castle smashed. It's like, let's build a real house for you to be safe inside of.
Foundation of real truth.
Come on.
Yeah, for real. Let's just talk about, the sonic template that you continue to build upon. The idea that these thoughts, maybe I'm looking too deeply into it, but I feel like the way your music sounds gives me the impression that keep the mic on at all times. I don't care where it is. I don't care what it sounds like to some degree. I want that spirit of being in the moment. I don't care if I'm outside, inside, in my car, on my phone, in the studio with Alchemist or a collaborator. I want to capture the moment.
Because of that, I try and control my environment, because I know the fleeting nature of like inspiration and like catching the spirit.
you know, your relationship, and I'm going to focus in on your relationship with Alchemist for a second, because he is like the producer equivalent. He will just make the hedge, and then he'll be like, okay, I know this one's going to snap and reach a bigger audience. And
no, he cares, bro. He cares
about the
lot,
detail.
Bro. He cares.
So he makes this stuff sound like it's like, oh, he just pulled a record out, looped it, and went on. But then you really listen to it.
And it's like, wow, there's a lot going on
here.
Yeah. Him and Otis, man, him and Madlib, bro.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, this is not just a loop.
It must be really fascinating for you, and you probably don't think back on it at all, but sometimes I think back on some of those earlier recordings that were considered so rough and rugged and raw at the time, the ones you did with your friends and then ultimately on your own. But compared to now and the tastefulness and the thought going into reduction, that they sound fully produced. They sound like progressive rap records.
You got to think about the influences. It's like with Al, even with Black, with Madlib, this is like, the influences is going back to like a certain place. With OF, our de facto leader, Tyler, like behind production stuff, who was like setting the tone for everything. Mm-hmm. This is a guy from a different school. This is Pharrell's school. This is
Stevie Wonder.
And then exactly, yeah. Quincy Jones.
Yeah.
So this is going to be like, you talk to Tyler, it's like, bro, you hear these chords?
He literally loves chords.
Like, he loves it. Yo, like, here, this is flexing on you with the bridge.
Constantly.
Like, that's his favorite thing. He's like, bro, the bridge? Like, do you hear this bridge?
Yeah.
It's like, it's different schools, bro. It's different schools, production schools. Also, a big part of the whole thing with sampling is like, you're showing who you are. You're showing what your influences are. You're almost showing how you grew up. And the realest ones, you're trying to pay homage to this thing. So you're honoring it with those details.
So as a real rap fan as well, so who was that for you? Who are those people that, like, you know, somewhere, even in your subconscious, that you just want to know that you feel like a contemporary and that you've made that mark?
It's been so many people, bro. Like, ever since I was like 12, that's kind of where I started rapping from. I would pretend that I was on songs with,
like, who?
One of the first verses I wrote was like "To Go Crazy" by Jeezy and Hove. I was like, yeah, I'm on this
what
song.
What if I got a hot 16 on this?
Yeah, yeah, like, yeah. What if I'm rapping on this song? And then I'll tell you a super one that, like, really, like, Mikey and Chuck, bro.
Cool Kids?
Cool Kids.
Oh, my gosh.
Cool Kids. Yo, we're gonna talk about Michael Rocks. Big, heavy schemes, right? Really masterful rapper.
And really masterful producer.
Chuck, really masterful producer. They left the open 16 on the second song on Gone Fishing. I was like, that's literally my verse.
I love that.
And then, you know, as like moving through time, then it was like Doom, Eminem, that is like that time. Obviously Wayne. Like, right now I'm talking about what went into my, like,
the architecture.
Initial, yeah.
Yeah.
I actually can't even take the blame for being born when I was born. I gotta put it on the niggas that was making music at the time that I was coming up. Cause the Nas album that I had, that
this is where all Illmatic fans cry in their soup.
I was 12.
Which one was it?
Hip Hop Is Dead, dog. That was, I was 12.
I'm not mad at that album.
But bro, that album is like the weirdest album, like, ever. He did a whole voice in an old timey, like, 20s criminal. He was like, man, see? Like, he did a whole song. Like, in that, I'm just saying, I grew up in weird times for rap. So as I started to get older, yeah. Slum Village, bruh.
Well, Jay Dilla, I mean, is pre and post. I mean,
yes.
that's a very much a pre and post moment.
Dilla, of course. Dilla was on his own, but I mean, bro, my shit was weird.
Even
like
the rap album.
I had the Detroit Deli album. That shit fucked me up. And that was like after Dilla died. Like, Dilla only had one on there. And yeah, like how you said, that's one thing about it, bro. Dilla raps. Dilla was one of the best rappers, bro. That's the whole thing.
So let's talk a little bit about like, if you don't mind, about the life that informs the art and informs the music, because, you know, you're an honest writer and, you know, you say a lot in your music about what you're going through in it, and you have become, whether you meant to or not, like, to some degree, you know, an inspiring advocate for that conversation about, like, hey, man, like, you know, I'm not all there. I don't have all the answers. I've been through some tough, la, 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 la. Mm-hmm. How are you sort of, like, on your own personal journey, aside from sharing it with us through music, how are you practicing improvement in your own life in order to kind of be, as you say, a complete vision of yourself moving forward?
For a long time, I think I made the mistake of thinking that it was like a before and after thing. Like, I would, like, reach a point and then you're, like, done struggling. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I'm good now. It's like, it's over. Mm. Which is not the nature of the game. A heartbeat, right? I learned about it through a heartbeat, right? How it looks on the thing. It's an up and down thing. I guess my goal is, once you get it to kind of control it, that becomes the line. You can kind of establish like
a through line.
A through line of, it's like a waveform, you know,
yeah,
what
you
I mean?
Start focusing on the actual curvature and start focusing.
Like,
on
that stops scaring you. Like, yeah, that motion stops scaring you so much. You kind of plan on it. So it's like, right now, I'm in a celebratory state. Like, we just dropped the thing, right? So it's like, I have this opportunity right now to, like, truly be happy. Mm. To be happy, how we were talking about. I have the opportunity to be happy. And because of my experience in life, I've been knocked down from being happy. It can make you a bit of a fatalist. You know, it's like, that's the type that makes people say, life is bad, which is just a lie. It's actually just a lie. That's what walked outside, and it's just gorgeous, man. That can be the most frustrating thing, bro, because if your cat just died and you want this to hailstorm or something, you know what I mean?
That's
you
why
wanna...
California's such a fucking sucker, because it constantly tries to tell you through sunshine and blue skies that, like, hey, it's all good. It's like, it actually has the opposite effect at times. This is depressive.
Yes, for sure. Like, being in this, like, celebratory state, right? It's like, sometimes I can treat goodness or happiness like it's my first time, like with my hands on, you know what I mean? And I'll like, and then I just like will slip out of my, so, cause I think you were asking me about, like, you know, life and how the strides that I make. For balance and improvement. It's like, for balance, what I'm trying to do right now, and I prayed on this yesterday, bro. Like, it was in my prayer, like, forgive me for the times that I haven't really treated what's been bestowed on me like the blessing that it is, which is sometimes just simply enjoying it. Like, I don't have to, like, overstate the enjoyment of it. Sometimes the enjoyment of it can just be enjoying that. Like, and you just move on. Like, it's like, cool. Just clear the deck, toast the drink, have fun, see where this takes you. I think for the first time, I'm like, yo, this is okay.